Congress moves closer to passing a revised version of the president's major infrastructure and spending legislation, but questions remain about the bill's fate. And frozen in time, how ice samples collected from endangered glaciers help us understand Earth's atmospheric history and could provide clues to the severity of climate change.
It is a wonderful recorder. It keeps what it captures. It's the only place that we have these records of the gaseous composition of the atmosphere.
All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
Fidelity Dedicated Advisors are here to help you create a wealth plan. A plan with tax-sensitive investing strategies. Planning focused on tomorrow, while you focus on today. That's the planning effect from Fidelity.
Johnson & Johnson. BNSF Railway. Consumer Cellular. Financial services firm Raymond James.
BDO, accountants and advisors.
The Candida Fund, committed to advancing restorative justice and meaningful work through investments in transformative leaders and ideas. More at CandidaFund.org. Carnegie Corporation of New York, supporting innovations in education, democratic engagement, and the advancement of international peace and security at Carnegie.org. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
The United States has now lost 750,000 Americans to COVID-19, another tragic milestone in the pandemic. Today, the Biden administration spelled out how it will require private businesses to ensure that employees get vaccinated against COVID-19 or submit to regular testing. The rule, which would go into effect January 4th, impacts some 84 million private sector workers. Amna Nawaz has the details.
Judy, that rule comes from the Department of Labor's Occupational Safety and Health Administration, or OSHA, and applies to private businesses with 100 or more employees. It mandates that workers who don't get fully vaccinated get tested weekly. And by that same January 4th deadline, 17 million healthcare workers in facilities that receive Medicare or Medicaid funding must get vaccinated. Marty Walsh is the Secretary of Labor, and he joins me now. Secretary Walsh, welcome back to the NewsHour. Thank you for making the time. So you're not requiring vaccines for those 84 million private sector employees. They can choose to get tested weekly. If we know shots work, we know that they slow the spread of the virus, they save lives, why not just require them?
Because what we want to do here is get as many people vaccinated as possible, and we have the option for testing there as well, and testing and also masks. So we looked at, you know, we didn't do a mandate. It wasn't a mandate. The emergency temporary standard, at least it recognizes people in different situations, and hopefully we'll be able to address all the different situations people might have.
But you did require them for those healthcare workers, right? Now, there's 17 million who work in those facilities. Why a requirement there?
Because that's a whole different case when we're talking about people working around other people with illnesses, and there was a different set of rules there.
And so what if those employees who are required, who don't have the option to just get tested, what if they refuse to get vaccinated?
In the first ETS?
No, in the second, specifically with the healthcare workers, for people who are required to get vaccinated by that January 4th deadline. If they refuse, what then?
Employers will be able to take the action that they think is right. And also, they're working with OSHA right now, and they've done it. They've had a 50-year history of making these rules work.
So let me ask you about what we've seen so far from private companies, because some have taken up their own vaccine mandates, right? United Airlines is one we often cite as an example. They've had high compliance, but others have not. Walmart, for example, one of the nation's largest employers. I'm curious why you think they have not put into place stricter regulations when it comes to requiring employees to get vaccinated.
I think a lot of people have concerns about how do we move forward here. This is kind of uncharted territory in the last 2 years with the coronavirus, and there's been different waves of virus increases, and the Delta variant was another one. So I think a lot of employers didn't exactly know how to proceed. And part of today with the emergency temporary standard, I think it'll give some employers a roadmap on the best way moving forward. You mentioned United Airlines and other companies have put in mandates. This is not a mandate, but they put in mandates. And they're seeing like 85-90% compliance. So what we're hoping here is that we'll see a high compliance rate in companies that might not have any type of vaccine program. This will allow them the opportunity to institute it. And then we want to, the bottom line here is creating a safe work environment mm-hmm. for workers to go to work.
Mr. Secretary, what about penalties? If companies aren't able to comply, meet that January 4th deadline, financial penalties, how do you actually enforce that?
Yeah, OSHA has a 50-year history of doing these, of compliance and working with temporary standards as we move forward here. So I'm confident that in the OSHA process, and we'll be working with employers as we move forward here, educating them on what will be their responsibility.
But to clarify, there could be financial penalties ahead for companies who don't comply, correct?
Yes, there could be, yes.
You mentioned those lawsuits. We know Republican attorneys general in a number of states are already ramping up to sue the federal government. They've called this overreach into the private sector. They call it unconstitutional. They say it's an imposition on personal choice. Are you confident that these rules will stand up in court?
Yeah, we are confident. It was a well-written rule and put together. A lot of thought went into it. And again, I think that, you know, that some of the companies around the country have already begun something like this and has put, in some cases, was a mandate. We were very thoughtful when we put this together that we're encouraging people to be vaccinated and businesses, obviously, to encourage people to be vaccinated. But there are other options in there, such as testing and masks.
What about states where the governor is explicitly directing their state Department of Labor not to comply? Indiana, for example. Are you telling those labor offices there to defy their governor?
We're not telling them to defy their governor. This law supersedes their rules in those states.
And what's your message to employers in some of those states where the leadership may not support these rules and regulations? How can you support them if they're trying to put these rules and regulations in place?
I've done a few interviews today, and everyone keeps focusing on the other side, that employers that don't want to put these cases in and employers that don't want to run these. I actually feel that there are more employers in this country that want these rules and want to institute these rules, and now we have the ability to do that. And I think that there are more people in this country that are supportive of vaccines and supportive of testing than not. And I think that, you know, as we move forward here, I'm going to stay positive on this and just continue to work with businesses and work with individuals and encourage people to get vaccinated until we're on the other side of this virus.
The Secretary of Labor, Marty Walsh, joining us tonight. Secretary Walsh, thank you so much for your time. Good to have you.
Thank you.
I'm Stephanie Tsai with NewsHour West. We'll return to the full program after the latest headlines. The Justice Department is suing Texas over its new voting law, stating that the new provisions for mail-in voting and voter assistance violate federal civil rights protections. Opponents of the bill accuse the Republican-backed measure of disenfranchising minorities and those with disabilities. In Kenosha, Wisconsin, at the murder trial of Kyle Rittenhouse, two defense witnesses testified that the first man Rittenhouse shot and killed had threatened to kill him and was hyper-aggressive, bolstering Rittenhouse's claim that he acted in self-defense. Rittenhouse killed two people and wounded a third during protests last year that erupted after police shot Jacob Blake. Earlier today, Judge Bruce Schrader dismissed a white juror in the trial, saying that he had joked about Blake.
It is clear that the appearance of bias is present, and it would seriously undermine the outcome of the case.
The public needs to be confident that this is a fair trial, and I think even at the very most, it was bad judgment to tell a joke of that nature.
Meanwhile, in Brunswick, Georgia, a nearly all-white jury will be seated tomorrow for three men accused of murdering Ahmaud Arbery. We'll return to this later in the program. A Russian analyst was charged today by a special counsel probing the origins of the Trump-Russia investigation. Igor Danchenko is accused of lying to the FBI. He provided opposition research to Democrats on ties between Russia and then-candidate Donald Trump in 2016. Later, federal officials used the dossier to justify surveillance of a former Trump aide. At the UN climate summit, more than 20 countries pledged to phase out coal use within the next two decades. They include several heavy users: Chile, Indonesia, South Korea, Ukraine, and Vietnam. The U.S. and others committed to curbing financial support for coal-fired power plants.
Coal financing has been well and truly choked off. We know that this transition must be just, and new tools for delivering the transition are emerging. Development banks, governments, philanthropies, and the private sector are coming behind it, helping countries across the world.
Some environmental groups complain the pledges are not ambitious enough. In Iran, thousands of people turned out for anti-American rallies that were canceled last year because of the pandemic. Crowds gathered in Tehran and other cities to mark the 1979 takeover of the U.S. embassy. They chanted "Death to America" and burned U.S. flags. The embassy crisis lasted 444 days before 52 American hostages were released. Back in this country, the NBA is investigating the owner of the Phoenix Suns, Robert Sarver, for allegedly making racist and misogynistic comments targeted at employees and players. An ESPN report quoted Suns employees who claim Sarver repeatedly used the N-word and made lewd comments about women. The league spokesperson said the allegations were extremely serious. Sarver said the report was inaccurate and that the N-word is not part of his vocabulary. The U.S. Senate confirmed Robert Santos for director of the census, the first person of color in that job. The 2020 census struggled with the pandemic and President Trump's bid to identify people in the U.S. illegally. And in economic news, new claims for jobless benefits fell again last week to 269,000, but the trade deficit hit a record high in September, nearly $81 billion. Still to come on the NewsHour, the controversy over the jurors selected in the trial of white men accused of killing Ahmaud Arbery. Georgia Secretary of State Brad Raffensperger discusses voting laws and his standoff with former President Trump. Ethiopia teeters on the brink of civil war as the situation in Tigray rapidly deteriorates, plus much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
With narrow margins in Congress, Democratic leaders continue their struggle to build a coalition to pass President Biden's Build Back Better agenda, as Lisa Desjardins reports with new details about how it will be paid for. Democrats are working to push it over the finish line.
Good morning. Good morning. Thank you for your patience.
Squarely on the shoulders of House Speaker Nancy Pelosi today, the pressure to pass the Biden agenda.
This is the greatest, monumental, historic piece of legislation that any of us have will ever be a part of it.
She means the Build Back Better Act, the sweeping legislation that would expand child care funding and would launch universal free pre-K. It also would invest billions in climate change initiatives and expand health care access, including by lowering some drug prices. But the bill again hit speed bumps with questions around its cost. Some answers and pages of hard numbers came today from the nonpartisan Joint Committee on Taxation, which estimated that the bill raises at least $1.5 trillion over the next decade. Democrats said hundreds of billions more are in sections the committee did not score, meaning it would cover the bill's costs. Pelosi highlighted the finding within minutes.
That's not Democratic, it's not Republican, it's objective view that it is solidly paid for.
All this as House Democrats work overtime.
We're talking about a multi-trillion dollar bill with over 2,000 pages.
Holding an 8-hour Rules Committee meeting last night to move the current version to the House floor, even as Republicans express opposition.
It is frustrating to be dealing with something that is so large, the biggest bill is ever passed. Really, do we understand exactly how this is all going to work? Because the language is a little confusing, and there's a lot of it, and it's detailed.
House Democrats have also made key revisions in their bill, adding work permits and a legal status for many undocumented immigrants, as well as a paid leave compromise to give 4 weeks of time to care for family. Still unclear is whether a key moderate, Democrat Joe Manchin, will accept the changes when the bill reaches the 50-50 Senate.
And for more on the state of play on Capitol Hill, Lisa joins me now. So, Lisa, our viewers may feel they've seen this movie before. Yes. Neither bill so far having a vote on the floor. Where do we stand?
As of this hour, we do not know what the rest of tonight will look like. It is possible that the House could still vote on the Build Back Better bill tonight. House Speaker Nancy Pelosi is trying to pressure those moderates who are now the ones holding out to get them on board. But as of this moment, they don't have the votes tonight. They may have to wait until tomorrow. Those moderates are saying they want to see the full bill. They're skeptical about some items. There are still some items being negotiated. I can run through them. That state and local tax provision, immigration, prescription drugs, methane, all of those have small snags. We can get into that. But Judy, what's really going on here is a problem of trust. And think of it sort of like a wedding, two people getting married. One of them has cold feet when the other is ready. That was progressives. Then progressives said, okay, we're ready to get on board. Now the moderates have cold feet. Literally at this moment, we are waiting to see if both sides in the House Democratic Caucus will say I do to what is a massive and the most important vote potentially of many of these Democrats' career.
No question. So, Lisa, when you mention still concerns over the cost, what specifically are the concerns?
You know I like talking numbers. So I think as the days ahead, we'll delve more into the numbers as we see the exact bill that gets passed. But when you look at this bill and what we've learned today from the Joint Committee on Taxation, $1.75 trillion, the important message here is that they believe that Democrats do pay for that. The two biggest parts of those pay-fors are the taxes on the wealthy and then also the corporate tax. Now, those are still items that could have problems in the Senate, potentially. It seems like everyone's on board. But one of the important points about that I want to make about this, however, is that it's paid for in part because some of these programs don't last for 10 years. Some of the most popular programs, including the child care tax, the child care tax credit, as well as the universal pre-K, those end in 3 to 6 years. So some of this, it is paid for. But when you look on deeper inspection, it's assuming that those programs won't last when, in fact, Democrats want them to be permanent.
Phasing, they had agreed, because they agreed to phase some things out that had been 10 years. So immigration, you mentioned that as one of the things still being debated. Where does that specifically stand right now?
Okay, so let's talk about the proposals on the table for House Democrats. This is an issue that many Democrats are wrestling with right now to see if they want to get on this bill or not. Here's where we stand. There is option one. This is an option having to do with the registry of immigrants in this country, and it would allow essentially for green cards and a path to citizenship for those who arrived in this country after 2010, or who have been here, who arrived before 2010. Let me make sure and get this straight. It's confusing. Moderates, however, are concerned because that's a large population. That would be millions of undocumented people in this country now, anyone who got here before 2010, essentially. The option two, though, that moderates like better is a status, not a green card, not path to citizenship. That's something that's called parole. It'd be 5 to 10 years of technical immigration parole. It would be extended to 5 years if people abide by the conditions. But progressives, of course, don't like that. So how do you square that circle? Those are the two issues, two ideas on the table now. Progressives say something's better than nothing. All of them concerned, Judy, because it's not clear either of these ideas can pass Senate muster, where the Senate parliamentarian, as our viewers know, has to say that anything in this bill is budgetary.
It's budgetary.
And there's nervousness across the House Democratic Caucus if any immigration can pass, and they vote for this without knowing or not.
Well, you were reporting yesterday this could take weeks, even after the House passes it, so there's some cushion in expectation, but the House vote.
This is a big moment. If the House does not get this done this week, they have a very serious problem with scheduling, and the Senate, Pelosi knows that. So the next 2 days are critical.
Lisa Desjardins, once again, on top of it all. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Just before opening statements are set to begin tomorrow, there are new questions about jury selection in the trial of the men charged with killing Ahmaud Arbery. Three white men are accused of murdering Arbery, who is black, in southeastern Georgia last year. Cell phone video showed the men chasing Arbery down, and it spawned nationwide protests. As John Yang reports, jury selection added even more questions about race into this trial.
Judy, in a county whose population is nearly 30% black, only one African American is on the jury of this racially charged case. The judge in the case said there appeared to be intentional discrimination on the part of the defense, but said he did not have the legal authority to do anything about it. Paul Butler is a professor at Georgetown Law and a former federal prosecutor. Thanks for being with us. What do you make of how this jury ended up?
You know, it almost sounds like a relic of the old South. We have a case in which an African-American man was hunted down and killed by three white men. Those men have been charged with a number of crimes, including murder, false imprisonment, and aggravated assault. And now they have virtually an all-white jury, 11 white people and one African-American. It doesn't sound like something that should happen in 2021, especially in a jury district that is almost one-third African-American.
You talk about a relic of the old South, and the relic of the old South, it would have been the prosecution that had done this, but here was the defense. Remind us how this process works and what latitude, what leeway the judge had to do something about this.
So during jury selection in a criminal trial, after the judge has found that potential jurors are qualified to sit on the case, both the prosecution and the defense get a certain number of strikes, which they can use to remove jurors for any reason other than race or gender. If one side believes that the other is improperly striking jurors because of race or gender, they can require the judge to hold a hearing. In that event, the person who is removing the jurors has to identify a race-neutral reason why they struck those jurors. It could be because of how they answered a particular question. So in this situation, the judge held that hearing yesterday and found that the reasons offered by the defense for getting rid of 11 out of 12 prospective African-American jurors were race neutral.
Even though he said in open court that he suspected that there was intentional discrimination going on, how unusual is it for a judge to say that and yet do nothing about it, let it proceed and not start all over again?
John, I've never heard of another case in which a judge has found intentional discrimination but then declare there's nothing that they can do about it in the jury selection process. What the judge said was that the reasons that were offered by the defense, including that some of the jurors knew, some of the prospective jurors had heard stuff about the case, had formed opinions or talked with family members about it, the judge found that all of those were race neutral. But if you look at other jurors, white folks who were allowed to remain on the jury, they answered some of the same questions the same way. For example, one white juror said that she thought that Mr. Arbery had been racially profiled. She's still on the jury. Another white juror said that she had long conversations with her husband about the case. She's still on the jury. So there's a concern that the defense used answers like that from black prospective jurors to strike them. And again, if they're treating African-American and white potential jurors differently, that's unconstitutional.
In this era of Black Lives Matter, what does the fact that this jury is largely white, what does it say to you?
It says that we have a long way to go for all Americans to realize equal justice under the law. The Supreme Court has said that it's important to have African Americans in cases that involve race because that makes the verdict more legitimate. In this case, if there's a verdict of not guilty or even a hung jury, almost certainly the fact that the jury was virtually all white will be blamed. Another interesting comparison to the Derek Chauvin prosecution is that in a lot of high-profile cases during the Black Lives Matter era, to the public, they're all about race. But race doesn't actually come up in the courtroom. It didn't in the Chauvin trial. It's unlikely to come up in the trial of Kyle Rittenhouse that's going on right now. But in this trial, race will be front and center. It's part of the prosecution's theory about why these men and how these men came to take the life of Mr. Arbery.
Opening arguments begin tomorrow. Paul Butler of Georgetown University, thank you very much.
Always a pleasure, John.
In the days and months following Donald Trump's presidential re-election defeat, several American election officials were subjected to threats and an intense pressure campaign by the outgoing president, desperate to stay in power. Perhaps none more so than Georgia's Secretary of State, Brad Raffensperger. In his new book, Integrity Counts, he explains his experiences and how close our democracy came to being dismantled. And he joins me now. Mr. Raffensperger, thank you very much for being here. You did step into history when President Trump attacked you after the election and asked you to change the results. You said no, and your book includes this a transcript of that, hour-long plus phone call you had with President Trump. You took that call to include threats from him. How so?
That was something that I think our office and I was well prepared for. In fact, when I stepped into the office in January 2019, we had the first thing was Stacey Abrams and about 9 lawsuits about that question of a stolen election claim concept that she had. It wasn't based on the truth, which was voter suppression. In 2020, it was voter fraud. Now they were based on the truth. And so we knew we had the facts on our side. And so I just needed to continue politely, respectfully, let the president know that he did lose the election and this is why. So we gave him data points and explained to him that all the data he had was just wrong.
What you say in the book is that you took what he said as threatening to prosecute you. I mean, the president essentially was asking you to break the law.
Asking us to find 11,800 votes, and there weren't 11,800 votes to find. They just weren't there. You know, he said that there was 5,000 dead people. There was less than 5. He said that there was, you know, thousands of felons that voted. There's less than 74. It just went down the line. He said there was underage voters, 66,000. There was 0. There was no underage voting in Georgia. And so we had the data. This calmly, factually, I laid that out. And that's what I do in my book, Integrity Counts. So people finally get the truth for the very first time.
You and every one of the Republicans who stood up for integrity, the title of your book, who denied that the election was fraudulent, and the Republicans who have opposed the January 6th attack on the U.S. Capitol, every one of you is now either facing being primaried by a Republican supported by President Trump or is leaving office, leaving politics altogether. And I could name Liz Cheney, Adam Kinzinger, and others. What's happened to this Republican Party? This is now the party of Donald Trump.
My reelection, I'm going to stand on the truth. I have truth on my side, and so I know that integrity counts. And I'm just going to lean into the goodness of the average American, the average Republican voter that are good, upstanding citizens. And that's why I wrote the book, so they have all the facts. I know those are the cold, hard, it's the brutal truth, but President Trump came up short in Georgia.
And my point is that the Republican Party is now turning against you and others who refuse to do what President Trump asked. But I want to ask you about the law that Georgia passed after the election, sweeping new set of election laws. If the election was fair, which you argue that it was, why was it necessary to institute a whole new set of election laws in Georgia?
Well, number one, the best thing I believe that we did with SB 202 is we moved away from signature match, which is subjective. In fact, I said in 2018, We need to go to photo ID for absentee voting like we have for in-person voting. And finally, we General Assembly did that this year. We'd been sued by both the Democrat Party and the Republican Party over signature match. They said it's subjective. I agree. And so now we've gone to an objective measure, which is driver's license number and birthday, day, month, year. This is something they've been doing in Minnesota for over 10 years now, and Texas has copied us and going to do the same thing. It's really a nonpartisan, bipartisan, it's an objective measure. And I think objective measures make a lot more sense and really help restore voter confidence, and there'll be less squabbling afterwards when it's done by objective measures.
And what about for those individuals who have to work long hours, have to work late shifts, may not have a driver's license? Why not make it easier for them to vote rather than much harder?
We've had photo ID in-person voting now for over 10 years, and studies have come out, and they've showed that neither Democrat or Republicans or any demographic group are hurt by photo ID. And actually, both parties and all demographic groups support it because they understand it helps ensure that you know who that is that's showing up to vote when they use photo ID. So we've incorporated that with the signature match moving away, and now all absentee voting will be with driver's license. It's very good, and we've actually increased the number of early voting days from 16 up to 17. That includes two Sundays, and then any county that needs to have it can have, at their choice, 2 days of Sunday voting. That's 19 days. That's more than New York, New Jersey, and Delaware.
I want to ask you about another couple of provisions of that new Georgia law, Mr. Raffensperger. One, of course, as you know, has to do with not allowing food or drink to be provided to people who are standing in line. We know that sometimes in Georgia and some parts of the state and some counties, precincts, long lines are necessary because of timing, because of where people work, what their availability is. How do you explain that it's wrong to give people a bottle of water or a snack if they are standing in a long line? And we know this in particular will be affecting voters of color, African American.
Well, number one, we also put in SB 202 that all lines need to be shorter than 1 hour. And if they are longer than an hour, next election doesn't solve the problem of that election, but next election, you have to bust that precinct in half, or you have to add additional equipment. That's a good accountability measure. But last November, the average wait time was 3 minutes in the afternoon, and the longest wait time I saw on our board that we were following was 50 minutes. So we've already worked hard with the counties to defeat that issue. But also, we have had, for time immemorial, a no politicking, no electioneering rule of 150 foot within that 150 foot zone. So outside of 150 foot, then if you want to use give people water or something like that, then you're allowed to do that. It's just within that 150 foot zone, it's no politicking, no electioneering. And states all have that. They have different zones. Some have 150, some have 100, some have 125. But that's standard operating practice in election.
And my understanding is that in very few states is this the practice. And so it just seems to be singling out those voters who may have difficulty getting to the polls and who may have to stand in line for a long time.
Well, like I said, we have up to 19 days in our large metro population centers. And so that's 19 days of early voting. And then we have no excuse absentee voting for everyone.
We're going to leave it there. Brad Raffensperger, who is Georgia's Secretary of State, out with a new book, Integrity Counts. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Judy.
The U.S. State Department is now allowing non-essential workers and family members to leave Ethiopia as rebel forces from the northern Tigray region approach the capital. The two sides and their allies have been fighting for exactly 1 year. And as Nick Schifrin reports, the conflict is on the brink of all-out civil war that threatens to tear apart the country. And a caution, images and accounts in this story may disturb some viewers.
On the one-year anniversary of the conflict, Ethiopian soldiers and officials lit candles for those they called martyred heroes. And while some protected flames from the wind, Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed fanned the flames of war.
We will bury this enemy with our blood and bones and uphold the glory of Ethiopia.
Government airstrikes target civilian infrastructure in Tigray's capital, Mekele. And the humanitarian crisis in Tigray is acute. 400,000 face famine. 5 million need aid to survive. But a senior official of the U.S. Agency for International Development tells PBS NewsHour the Ethiopian government and its allies have blocked all aid for 2 weeks by barring these trucks from entering Tigray. And now Tigrayan forces are advancing south. Analysts warn the country's fate is at stake. The crisis began exactly 1 year ago when Tigrayan forces who used to run the country attacked a federal outpost. Federal forces and their allies from neighboring Eritrea and the Amhara region waged a scorched earth campaign and occupied parts of Tigray. But in late June, Tigrayan forces pushed federal Ethiopian soldiers out and kept going from Tigray into neighboring Amhara and Afar, and now toward the capital, Addis Ababa. They captured two key towns and allied themselves with a small militia from the Oromo ethnic group, to which Abiy also belongs. Throughout, it's been a year of what the UN calls unprecedented brutality.
There are reasonable grounds to believe that war crimes and crimes against humanity have been committed by all parties to the conflict.
Marit Kohonen Sharif is the Africa Director for the United Nations High Commissioner on Human Rights, which yesterday released the first official account of the war's horrors, a joint investigation with the Ethiopian government.
The joint investigative team was looking into executions, summary arbitrary killings, into arbitrary detentions, into violence against women, gang rape, multiple sexual violence against boys, the destruction, the looting of property, livelihoods, the destruction of medical centers, and the fact that humanitarian aid has not reached those in need.
That list of atrocities, according to our reporting, was committed almost entirely by Ethiopian Defense Forces and their allies. Do you acknowledge that?
Yes. In the period of the specific investigation report between November and June, the majority of the violations were indeed committed by the Ethiopian Defense Forces, the Eritrean National Defense Forces, as well as the Amhara Regional Forces and their allies.
But since then, the report deals Tigrayan forces advancing and killing hundreds of civilians, sometimes with axes and machetes.
We have indeed documented several of those incidents where Tigrayan forces have caused tremendous suffering, whether it's to Amharans or other ethnic groups in the region.
The UN says its investigators were intimidated, harassed, and blocked from visiting the sites of massacres. One was expelled by the Ethiopian government.
The intimidation of the team was unacceptable. It was by regional authorities, by sometimes even by the civilian population, because you would have seen the incitement on social media.
But because UN investigators teamed up with Ethiopian officials, Tigrayan officials called the report, quote, an affront to the notion of impartiality.
Are you withholding some criticism of the Ethiopian government in order to keep working with them?
Absolutely not. We are impartial to the parties. We don't get involved in the political conflict, but we're not neutral to the suffering of the victims. The intention of this report is precisely to put a legal obligation on the duty bearers, that being the government and the authorities of Ethiopia, to take the steps for legal criminal investigations to establish accountability. But to be honest, without the joint investigation, we would not have been able to access the victims.
The world is calling for an immediate ceasefire. Today, U.S. Envoy Jeffrey Feltman is in Addis. But international pressure is not working. The Ethiopian military's second highest officer, General Bacha Debele.
We don't need to heed the advice of foreigners about how to deal with this conflict. This is our war against those who attempt to enslave us.
But there are fears the Ethiopian military cannot protect the capital. And the UN warns the stability of Ethiopia and the wider region is at stake.
Ethiopia borders on countries that already have very unstable situations. So the conflict, as it is escalating, can seriously destabilize the entire Horn of Africa. The ones who have any territorial control in this country need to step up, you know, for the love of the people, for the love of the country, because otherwise there will be no Ethiopia anymore.
Tonight, there is real fear the capital could be overrun. The Tigrayan rebel army is advancing, and there's little to stop them. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Nick Schifrin.
As negotiators at the climate change conference in Glasgow, Scotland continue their work, the impacts of a warming world are more evident every day. Many of the Earth's glaciers are in jeopardy because of what humans have already put into the atmosphere. William Brangham brings us this profile of a couple in Columbus, Ohio, who have dedicated their scientific careers to preserving and studying these crucial, endangered parts of our planet's ecosystem.
This is one of the rarest, most unusual collections in the world. Row upon row of long silver tubes full of ice.
Where we're about to go, I gotta dress like I'm ready for the Arctic.
To see them requires some suiting up. Lonnie Thompson and his wife, Ellen Mosley Thompson, created this archive here at the Ohio State University's Bird, Polar, and Climate Research Center.
We have a collection of ice cores from glaciers from all over the world. We've been fortunate to be able to drill in 16 different countries in addition to Antarctica and Greenland. And we keep this archive frozen at minus 30 degrees Fahrenheit.
You heard that right, minus 30. It's what's needed to preserve these cores, which have been drilled down into the world's glaciers. They come out as these cylindrical, layered records of the past.
So this is what an ice core looks like. When it comes out of the drill, we put it in the plastic bag. We label it so we know exactly where we are. This core goes back 13,500 years.
So this is going backwards in time.
It is.
The Thompsons have been collecting and studying these cores since the 1970s. Lonnie works on the high tropical glaciers around the equator, while Ellen focuses on the polar regions.
Did you and Lonnie intentionally divide up the world where you get the top and bottom and he gets the middle?
We had a daughter at home, and his field seasons working in the low latitudes are June, July, and August. If I'm working in Antarctica, I'm working December, January, February.
I see. So you can co-parent.
It's the name of the game.
It's a division of labor and love that's worked well in their 50-year partnership, one that began at college in West Virginia.
And this is when Ellen and I got married.
Oh my gosh, look at you two.
Yeah, we're just kids.
How old were you?
We were married in June, and I turned 23 in May, and you were still 22.
I was just a baby.
Well, I robbed the cradle, right?
I wasn't that much older myself when I first met these two. That's me over 20 years ago, a young producer and brand new father, 19,000 feet up on Mount Kilimanjaro in Tanzania, filming with the Thompsons' colleagues who were studying those glaciers and their connection to climate change. From Africa to Antarctica to South America, the Thompsons' expeditions have taken them to some of the most extreme remote locations on the planet. And they both admit, at first, they didn't set out to study climate change.
I mean, we started in the 1970s. In the 1970s, people were concerned about the Earth getting colder and going into another ice age.
And you thought, oh, this is a growth opportunity.
Right. We had little idea what we were getting into. But the purpose was to go into places where we had no records.
It is a wonderful recorder. And the unique thing about it is it keeps what it captures, and it's the only place that we have these records of the gaseous composition of the atmosphere.
And we can actually relate the records from Kilimanjaro or Huascarán or Calcaya to the rise and fall of cultures, and climate has played a big role.
The Quilcaya ice cap in Peru is one Lonnie has returned to over and over again, and it, like so many tropical glaciers on Earth, are disappearing right before our eyes. In some cases, this archive at The Ohio State University may be one of the last records of those glaciers left on Earth.
Here's just one example. 20 years ago, when I was on Kilimanjaro, I stood next to this glacier, the Furtwängler Glacier, where all these samples came from. Now, because of climate change, that glacier is gone. This is all that is left.
I've often thought that if we had a glacier in Ohio that people would see every day and watch how it is behaving, we would have very few climate deniers.
Their latest drilling expedition was in 2019 to Huascarán in Peru, before the pandemic brought travel to a screeching halt. Some of the cores from that trip are now coming out of cold storage and being studied by French postdoctoral student Émilie Baudon. She was in Peru when these cores were collected, and now she's taking samples to study what was captured inside that ice.
Does it ever strike you when you're holding something like that to think, this is 6,000, 7,000 or older years ago, the atmosphere on Earth back then?
Every single time I process a piece of ice, I connect with that thought. And it's mesmerizing. I really have to make sure I look at it. There are many things to see in ice. You could see, oh, it's just a piece of solid water. It makes you think also about your next research question.
Baudon and her colleagues then melt down the samples and examine what was frozen inside centuries ago. Dust, minerals, volcanic ash, even samples of our ancient atmospheres trapped inside tiny bubbles. The Thompsons' trips to collect these cores come with their own challenges. Moving heavy drilling gear up and down a mountain at high altitude, keeping those cores frozen solid all the way back to Columbus, Ohio. Even playing something of a cultural ambassador when under the threat of being shot with arrows.
Papua Indonesia, New Guinea, what used to be New Guinea, and it's the only ice field between the Himalayas and the Andes. The Mungmi tribe, they attacked us while we were drilling, 150 of them. But we
literally attacked you?
Yes.
Attempted.
We were drilling up in the clouds. I mean, this is the rainiest place on Earth.
Why were they so upset you were there?
In their religion, the arms and legs of their gods are the mountains and the valleys. The head of their god is the glacier. And in their words, we were drilling into the skull of their god to steal their memories. And I told him that is exactly what we're doing. And I said that the day will come very soon when the only memories of your god will be in a freezer at Ohio State University.
It's true. As soon as 2 years from now, that very glacier will likely be gone. Satellite images show its rapid shrinkage over the last 30 years. For the Thompsons, the ultimate challenge is getting the world to recognize the very real impact humans are having on the planet.
Climate change is no longer in the future. It's here now. But I take hope in the fact that we do change, and we can change, and we can change on a dime.
Mm-hmm.
You can look at our history. I mean, we've gone through energy transformations. I mean, we didn't leave the Stone Age because we ran out of stones. We found a better way to do it.
You know, on the back end, BP and Exxon are working on renewable energies, but they're not going to give up on the big fat cow that they've got right now. And so it's going to take time, and it's going to take the political will. I mean, people will have to change because Mother Nature isn't going to change.
The Thompsons hope to keep their work going for years to come. Their next drilling operation is already planned. And to keep climbing those high peaks, Lonnie got a heart transplant. Now it's the freezer's turn. They say they need a bigger and newer one to preserve all those ice cores and the many discoveries still frozen inside them. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm William Brangham in Columbus, Ohio.
As we've reported, the U.S. has passed another tragic pandemic milestone. 750,000 Americans have died from COVID-19. Dr. Sanjay Gupta is focusing in part on what governments and people could have done differently. Here's the second part of my conversation with him about his book, World War C, Lessons from the COVID-19 Pandemic and How to Prepare for the Next One. Welcome to the NewsHour. We appreciate your joining us. You spent several hours last month talking to Joe Rogan, who is a talk show host, part of his podcast, essentially trying to change minds to explain to people what the vaccine is. Did you come away from that with a better understanding of why people have this reluctance, of how ingrained these views are?
Well, I have a better understanding that it is very real, the skepticism. I think sometimes you think that, look, logic will prevail, right? I mean, this is a vaccine that can save lives. It was the moonshot of scientific developments. That should win the day, ultimately. But you come to find out that there is a significant amount of resistance, reluctance, hesitancy, whatever you want to call it. There's two things that really came out of it from my conversation with Joe Rogan. First of all, as we've democratized information more and more, it's really hard for people to tell good information from bad information, good information from misinformation. And there is true disinformation out there, which is purposeful misinformation. And it's really hard for the average person to sort of parse it out. If you were to just Google anything right now, vaccines can kill you. If you were to just Google that, you would find a few papers and lots of websites to sort of validate your beliefs. What are we going to do going forward, especially in situations like this, when the quality and the veracity of that information really matters? The second thing is, who do we trust? And why has there been an erosion of trust in pharmaceutical companies, in mainstream media, in large institutions overall? And as a result, when you suddenly say, you get these vaccine requirements that are coming out, there is a significant pushback because there's already this distrust there that's been festering to begin with. Those two things in combination, Judy, can make a very, very toxic, environment for people who are trying to sort of navigate this through. It's not everybody, and maybe it's not even the majority of people, but it's enough people out there who have the distrust fueled by bad information to lead them to these decisions.
And in connection with that, just quickly, the reluctance we're seeing now on the part of many parents of young children, now that the vaccine's been approved, the Pfizer vaccine, for young children. Is that a different argument to be made to them?
Yeah, I think so. I think that the change in the thinking has to be that, look, we know that children are less likely to get sick, they're less likely to be hospitalized, less likely to die, and that's all good. But there is still significant risk there, and how people sort of balance that risk. When the chickenpox vaccine came out a couple decades ago, it was a big deal. It was really heralded as a big scientific achievement. Prior to the chickenpox vaccine in the United States, about 100 children died of chickenpox every year. That was unacceptable, and we needed to have this vaccine. Now, we know that over 700 children have died of COVID over the last year and a half, and because we're putting it in the context of adults, we think, well, this doesn't seem like that big a deal. It is a big deal for those children and overall for all of us, because the more people that are vaccinated, the more likely we are to bring this to an end.
One other thing I want to ask you about, and this brings us back to the book, and I found it especially interesting, is your advice to people, pretty simple advice, but it is to stay healthy in order to fight off the next pandemic or whatever it is that's like the pandemic in the future. Spell that out for us.
Yeah, we always note these pandemics disproportionately affect certain countries. And that happened here as well, but almost in the exact opposite way that you'd expect. Wealthier countries were hit much harder, as a general rule, than poorer countries. And if you drill down on that, a lot of it had to do with the fact that there's lots of diseases of affluence, if you will, in wealthier countries. Diabetes, heart disease, obesity. These same diseases that put people at much higher risk of developing severe COVID if they were to get infected. So, we've known, obviously, for some time that there's great value in staying healthy, but oftentimes the argument, Judy, has been eat right and exercise and you can avoid a heart attack, decades from now. What I think this pandemic put into clearer focus was the real benefit of maintaining good health right now. People who were healthier when they got infected were much likely to do a lot better in terms of their outcomes.
Dr. Sanjay Gupta, really good to see you. Thank you so much.
My honor, Judy. Great to see you.
Really fascinating stuff in that book. And on the NewsHour online, Colin Powell will be honored in a funeral service tomorrow afternoon at the Washington National Cathedral. Our own Nicole Ellis sits down with a panel of guests for a look back at the life and legacy of the first Black Secretary of State and Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. That's tomorrow, starting at 11 a.m. Eastern on pbs.org/newshour. And that is the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Judy Woodruff. Join us online and again here tomorrow evening. For all of us at the PBS NewsHour, thank you. Please stay safe, and we'll see you soon.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by...
The rules of business are being reinvented with a more flexible workforce, by embracing innovation, by looking not only at current opportunities, but ahead to future ones.
People who know BDO.
For 25 years, Consumer Cellular has been offering no-contract wireless plans designed to help people do more of what they like. Our U.S.-based customer service team can help find a plan that fits you. To learn more, visit consumercellular.tv.
Johnson & Johnson. BNSF Railway. The Ford Foundation, working with visionaries on the front lines of social change worldwide. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. And friends of the NewsHour. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you. This is PBS NewsHour West. From WETA Studios in Washington and from our bureau at the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
You're watching PBS.